using big data to anticipate car accidents based on weather forecasts in Chicago so they could deliver the right spare parts to repair houses. Someone else saying, you know, 2/3 of the food that we deliver, fresh fruit and vegetable, gets spoiled in transit because it can't get to the right market. So if you're fixing the speed with which you repair cars and replacing the food supply, I mean, those are very human factors. This is no longer bits and bytes. And it's that humanizing element of what this stuff can do that's almost like a superpower.
It's almost a dual conference. You have the geeky conversations, the alpha geeky conversations around, you know, the Hadoop and the Greenfields and MongoDB and all the different Cassandra, so on and so forth, data warehousing, business intelligence. And then you have this whole application mindset where there's real impact, not just for business, but society. Ed, what are you seeing out there at that level of, what are some of the exciting bullet points that you can share with folks out there on how big data is really changing the world?
Well, I think one of the most interesting things as this goes into an organization is that people start off with, maybe they'll do a pilot project, and then suddenly they find out, once they've used Hadoop once for something and built kind of a platform, they're able to get out data. Often it's the unexpected things that are really creating value, and we're excited that one of the things we talk about alongside big data is data science. And the word science is so important because people are experimenting and exploring and making discoveries in their organizations and in the world that they didn't know were there before. So I think a lot of this, we're still very early stage, still really feeling things out, still answering the questions of what this is going to do for me. But it's the unexpected things that are definitely the
What's the most provocative thing that you've seen here, guys? If you guys can both comment, that'd be great. I want something that you go, wow, that's really provocative. And Elsa, you mentioned some of the things you mentioned about the applications. What's really the most provocative, most interesting thing?
So there was a discussion which sounds very esoteric, but it's actually really, really important. There was a big debate a couple of days ago about whether you don't need a hypothesis anymore or a domain expert anymore once you have the data. And there's a great example where they took, if you see the movie Moneyball, you got all these scouts who, they look for a kid's arm and whether his girlfriend's attractive as an indicator of his playing success. And instead a couple of people show up with a spreadsheet and beat all the other teams, right? That's a case where you take a guy who doesn't have domain expertise, but he's good with numbers, can beat a bunch of people who've been doing it all their lives. And so some people claim that the importance of being able to, of domain experts, to being an expert in your field, goes away once you have enough information. The data beats expertise. That's a really, really threatening thing for everybody who's got a career where they're a domain expert, because it means that someone with a spreadsheet and the right data can beat you. So while that sounds pretty esoteric, you know, data beats hypothesis, the consequences of that are everybody who's got a job because they're good at their job.
Yeah. It sounds scary.
It's no longer important. It's terrifying.
Right. It sounds scary. Abhi Mehta, who was one of the keynotes you guys brought on, who's a fantastic speaker, who's been on theCUBE multiple times, back at Hadoop World 2010, he talked about the Industrial Revolution, data factories, and the paradigm of, hey, you know, I mean, it's going to be scary for some people. There's going to be some displacement.
Right.
What are you seeing around that kind of conversation? Because it's not just one industry. It's government. We had someone on from the Chicago Metropolitan Information Center talking about some of the things she's working on. You got Gov 2.0, which you guys are heavily involved in. It's just not government. It's data sets.
Yeah.
Right. So ownership, all these debates going on around this. Is that part of the program? I mean, it's more conversation crap.
Yeah. So, I mean, one of the kind of the big pictures stories I'm telling is that we are where we are because data is now like a nervous system inside our companies, right? It used to be it was support structures, made everything go faster that was there before, replaced existing processes. But now it's on the inside, we're seeing this kind of shift in power, shift where in the kind of skills we need to use it. And so we have these things that are popping up all the time, you know, the Target story about the 16-year-old pregnancy that Target alerted the father to because of the promotional flyer they sent in, but all these unexpected things that are happening. And we as an industry don't just need the scientists to exploit the data, but we need policymakers, we need anthropologists to understand what has actually been a very fundamental change, that computers are on the inside of what we do now, where they used to be on the outside.
Guys, if you can share with the audience out there, I see you've been involved in the show, in the planning process, the execution, we're in the last day of the show here. What was it all about here? Okay, from a show standpoint, and it's really just reiterating what people might know, but what expectations were met, exceeded, changed, and how did the crowd here play into that? Because obviously, We care about the big data around the crowd impact because you guys, they're here, and we see it on Twitter, right? So share with us that, and then talk about the vision for Strata. We know that you guys announced you're merging Hadoop World with Strata, which is fantastic. It takes a big monkey off Cloudera's back in terms of organizing that massive show with last year's a sellout. Fire marshals were all over the Hilton in New York. So talk about the show, what's happened here, and for the folks who couldn't make it, and then the vision for Strata evolving.
I think one of the challenges is big data is so instrumental to all of our lives that we're going to see the focus on specific topics. You could easily envision Strata focused on healthcare or policy making or retail or high-level CEO decision making. And how does a company? We had a Diego Sanz was talking about Procter & Gamble's boardroom, which is an analytics sort of bat cave where they can crunch numbers in real time. How are CEOs going to go there? So I think what you'll see is that there's a lot of specialized discussions around different disciplines. Certainly we're thrilled at the attendance, we're thrilled at the number of exhibitors. We've also seen a change in the kind of people that are here. Someone came up to me and said, dude, there's a lot of suits here. And that's really, to your point, this convergence of, I've got business problems, maybe data can help me. I've got data tools, maybe they can solve a business problem. That's kind of the Reese's peanut butter cup of those two worlds colliding, which is hopefully a delicious candy bar.
Just a quick question on the attendee profile and demographics. Obviously, it's still a hot developer market. We were commenting earlier. There's a lot of recruiting going on. You guys have little buttons, hire me kind of thing. I mean, it's a massive. Facebook's got their little booth over there, basically recruiting. It's great. I mean, people need scientists, right? So, is there going to be more developer-focused content, and/or was there feedback on that? Did you guys hear people say, "Hey, not enough deep dives," or was that cool? Or will there be separate mini summits? Strata events where you can do more drill downs on developers, or what was the feedback on
so,
that?
So right now we do have a very broad-based audience, and I think that's appropriate as everybody from product managers to developers are trying to understand how they can use data, policymakers, entrepreneurs. And so we keep that, and in this show I think is a pretty good template for what you can expect from the rest of the year, where we go deep on Hadoop, deep on stuff that works, and deep on stuff about business strategy at the same time, and deep on data science. At this point, we have these three big audiences, and we're a great home where they can intermingle.
Yeah, I think that's a really good strategy. And in fact, we've been hearing a lot about the cultural fit, or lack of fit, or change, depending on how you want to look at it, between the old data warehouse business intelligence markets, which is big business. I mean, that's a lot of, it's an industry. And then also the greenfield with Hadoop. So there is an educational process. Talk about the data science MBA with Jumpstart program. We had Bill Schmarzo on. We call him the dean of big data because he's just so dynamic and pleasurable to listen to and knowledgeable. How did that go, and what's some session? What came out of that session?
Yeah, so Jumpstart was started with the notion that in many cases you have a business problem. Can you solve it with data? And Bill did a great job. I mean, he actually had Michael Porter's business consulting group stuff and, all these matrices. And it was like a run down memory lane for anybody who's done business school. And I surveyed the room, and about 35% of people in the room, plus or minus 5%, because we're at a stats conference, 35% of the people in the room said they had MBAs, which was quite high. And I think one of the things that we really found was there's a hunger for how to apply this stuff to business decision making, because once upon a time you'd make a decision and then a quarter later you'd get back your numbers and you'd see if it worked. Now you can sort of fire up a tablet on your desk and try something. And the expectation of business people who they walk in knowing more about their friends, what they had from dinner on a Facebook feed, than whether they're going to make the quarter or where their trucks are, that's not going to stand. So there's a whole shift in
expectations. There's a whole training. We're talking to Cloudera, who's been very successful this year and hugely successful, I think they're going to do this year. Dave Vellante forecasts they're probably double sales just by hitting the alarm clock. He thinks they'll do well above that in terms of revenue, which is fantastic for an open source company like that. So, but in talking to Sarah over there, who runs training, they have massive success with their deal. There's a 5,000 training center. There's a huge emphasis on training.
Yeah.
And the
yeah.
human capital here is just, it's embryonic. It's not enough. There's not enough people.
And I don't know if business people can even understand how to ask the right questions yet. So that's a large part of what we're going to spend time teaching.
What are you guys going to do about that problem? I mean, you guys have a strategy with Strata. Obviously, we love the data scientist workshop. We see an educational need. What's going on in the market? What is needed, or what's going on that people can go to? What resources are you seeing?
Well, we're doing several things. I mean, one of our big jobs for this conference is to try and make sense of the marketplace right now. I spent, a lot of January writing a lot of material about exactly where everybody sits and how they stack up and what's real. I think one of the other really important things coming through this year is going to be the increased importance of visualization. You talked about the skills gaps, and what we want to be able to do is give non-mathematically trained people the skills to be able to have a fingertip feel for the data. So it's not just about boring old dashboards. And tablet technology is absolutely vital in this, yes, that people can see the data, then they can stick their finger in it, move it around, get that dynamic, which is what data scientists have built into their gut. But we want that to, so business people can have that too.
Yeah, I made a tweet prior to coming here only to goof on the TED conference because I love the TED videos and, it's intellectual candy really for the brain in my mind. I love TED. But I was calling this conference the TED for the real world in the sense that there's a little bit of TED here in the sense that there is a cultural mindset change that intellectually is challenging.
Did you just call us a brand muffin?
Huh?
Did you just call us the brand muffin of conferences?
lace brand muffins maybe.
That's nice, not, nice. Maybe a carrot cake.
Cookies, brownies. What's next? So final question for you guys. What's next this year? Obviously, the Hadoop world integrations is big news. We love that. That's probably going to go to the next level. Venue changes, obviously, busting out the seams. Program changes. For the folks who don't know, you can go to O'Reilly blog. These guys are posting their roadmap there as well. But just in general, share with the folks out there the vision and what's the next steps. What are you going to build on? What are you going to tweak?
Well, Ed and I split duties pretty well. We have different backgrounds and very complementary backgrounds. So I've been running a lot of the online conferences. I ran the Startup Showcase, Jumpstart, some of that stuff. Ed is focused on the core content and the really high-end speakers and so on. I know we're going to be developing more of the Jumpstart program. That was packed rooms.
Absolutely.
I had to tell the people to sit down and make room four times during the day. That vibe of solving business problems with data, I think, will play really well in the Big Apple. And so we're definitely going to ramp that up a lot. We saw a ton of success around that theme. And I think maybe even go a little higher up the food chain to the CIO, CTO as part of that develops, because there's an increasing hunger to understand how this is going to affect
applications.
Yeah.
Particularly, right? Because the application surge,
Sure.
We're also looking at geographic expansion, so hopefully we'll have some news confirmed pretty shortly about China and London to add to this. So we're very excited.
Congratulations. Program chairs from Strata, Ed Dunville, Alistair Kroll, great guys. You should follow them on Twitter, find out where they are. Just go on Google search. Go to O'Reilly. Their blog is fantastic. These guys are expanding. This is a real, real game-changing trend. Great to be part of it. I'm really psyched for you guys. Congratulations.
Thanks.
And we'll take a quick break.